I begin today with a warning from the past. It was January 2nd, 1939, that anxious moment in history. The world was on edge as fascism spread its hate and destruction through Europe. On that day, California Governor Colbert Olson delivered an inaugural address to raise the alarm with lawmakers and the people of this great state. He spoke of California's most determined task in the face of quote-unquote destruction of democracy. At that moment, the state's highest calling was the preservation of our American civil liberties and democratic institutions. This year, we face another extraordinary moment in history for California, for the country, and the world. We are presented with a choice between a society that embraces our values and a world darkened by division and discrimination. The economic prosperity, health, safety, and freedom that we enjoy are under assault. Forces are threatening the very foundation of California's success, our pluralism, our innovative spirit, and our diversity. There's only one state in America with a dream, the California dream. It's a dream built on opportunity, a dream built on pushing boundaries and celebrating, not tolerating, diversity. That dream propelled us to the front of the pack to be the fifth largest economy in the world. Our values and our way of life are the antidote to the poisonous populism of the right and the fear and anxiety that so many people are feeling today. People across the globe, they look to California to see what's possible. Now we can live together and advance together and prosper together across every conceivable and imaginable difference. But the California way of life we recognize is under attack. For conservatives and delusional California bashers, their success depends on our failure. They want to impeach the very things that have made us successful as a tactic to turn America towards a darker future. They do so in the name of quote-unquote liberty and freedom. They want to roll back at the same time social progress, social justice, racial justice, economic justice, clean air, clean water, and basic fundamental fairness. They would cleave America from the principles of freedom and the rule of law. And in the process, threw our economy and in many respects society as we know it into chaos. But California, we won't bend. We are a success story exactly because of our universality and our extraordinary diversity and because we practice pluralism. For generations, we've stood for progress, championing women's rights and LGBTQ rights, protecting the environment and expanding civil rights. We see this hard-earned progress not as something apart from liberty and freedom, but as their fulfillment. Sadly, there is another way to see the world. Those bent on putting America on a darker course choose chaos over stability at every turn. For our detractors, the distorted prism of political pandering means cutting healthcare benefits and telling a woman she's not in charge of her own body. When it comes to reproductive rights, their lies are designed to control. Their draconian policies are driving women to flee across state lines as fugitives from laws written by men more than 100 years ago. Some even go so far as to force victims of assault to give birth to their rapist babies. As extreme politicians in other states take away women's rights, California stands as a beacon of self-determination. Together with this legislature, we have passed some of the strongest laws in the nation protecting women's health. Thanks to Senator Nancy Skinner and Tony Atkins and Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kounalakis, we've stood firm against radical lawmakers who would criminalize women in other states. And with your help, we are protecting women, Medi-Cal providers, doctors, healthcare facilities from the forces of darkness in this country. We will never turn our backs on women or threaten their freedom to travel. When it comes to the southern border with Mexico, California has proven time and time again that it's willing to tackle the hardest problems. But Republicans in Congress choose cynicism and the dangerous path of chaos instead of doing their job to help us secure the border. Think of this. For all their talk of securing the border, they rejected over and over and over again the opportunity to add thousands of new border agents and new immigration judges, as well as personnel, and hundreds of millions of dollars to support local communities near the border. And for what? Pure, unadulterated partisan politics. When they speak about immigrants poisoning American blood and mass deportations and detention camps, this is the language of destruction of 1939, when Governor Olson issued his warning. California is home to the busiest land port in the Western Hemisphere, and we've addressed the problems at the border with resolve. We also addressed it with resources, not plain politics. I'll give you an example. The vast majority of fentanyl seized at the border, we know, comes through ports of entry. And that's exactly why we've deployed the National Guard to stop the flow of this deadly drug into our state and the impact it has across the United States, allowing Border Patrol agents to do their job. These operations have resulted in the seizure of over 62,000 pounds of fentanyl in 2023, a 1,066% increase since 2021. In the first 5 months just of this year alone, counter-drug operations have led to the seizure of some estimated 5.8 million pills containing fentanyl statewide. At the same time, California has proudly provided humanitarian assistance and temporary shelter to migrants and their families along the border communities, easing the burden to local cities. Unfortunately, California has largely had to go this alone, again, because Republicans in Congress, when presented with an opportunity to assist border states, have turned their back. They've chosen politics, chosen inertia, and they've advanced pure political pandering. When it comes to America's homeless problem, California's detractors have similarly offered nothing but rhetoric, moaning, and casting blame. No state, by the way, has done more as California in addressing this pernicious problem of homelessness plaguing cities and towns, not just across the state of California, but increasingly across the United States. Too many politicians for too long have ignored this problem. Let me remind you, just as an example, when I got here in 2019, there was no state homeless strategy, no state homeless plan. There was no significant investment. Sure, there was a $500 million contribution one time made to local government, but there was no expectation of anything in return, accountability. There was no demonstrable results expected. When I came into office, we wanted to change that paradigm. That's why I presented a state of the state exclusively on the issue of homelessness and mental health. This was my commitment to California. We would no longer ignore this most pressing and distressing problem. Since then, by the way, we've cleared now over 9,300 dangerous encampments, and we're helping tens of thousands of people move from tents and freeway underpasses to shelter or housing. Our innovative Home Key program has revitalized former motels, hotels, and apartments, and provided more than 15,300 units of housing. Combined with Project Room Key, California has now provided shelter for more than 71,000 people. While the causes of homelessness are indeed complex, the solution is rather simple: housing and supportive services. Housing and supportive services. That's why we've focused our reforms specifically to address the housing needs as it relates to reforming CEQA. I've signed now 32 CEQA reforms to build more housing faster, at the same time creating more accountability by establishing a housing accountability unit to hold cities and counties accountable to following the law. Here are the results. Just in the last year or two, we've seen some 442 actions against local government, including lawsuits to compel them to follow the law. The success of accountability in the housing space is why we're adding similar accountability and oversight for homelessness. We're requiring cities now and counties to account for how they spend taxpayer dollars to get people off the streets and sidewalks, out of tents, and into housing. Look, it's so long as there are people living outdoors, so long as people are suffering from bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, paranoia, self-medicating with drug or alcohol addictions, our work clearly is not done. Most importantly, though, we have created a mosaic of extraordinarily transformative and impactful mental health reforms. We started with a new paradigm of thinking, Care Court, a nation-leading effort that provides treatment and housing for people with the most serious untreated mental health challenges. This is critical to help exhausted and financially stressed families that have been trying to help relatives, loved ones, stuck in the dark, in unimaginable pain, suffering so often alone. Thanks to Susan Eggman, Tom Umberg, this program is moving out of the pilot phase. It'll be up and running in every county in the state of California by the end of this year. We also took on the difficult and politically fraught task of conservatorship reform. How many decades have we been discussing the issue of conservatorship reform, saying it was necessary but increasingly impossible to achieve. Well, we achieved it. Now, for the first time, we're helping to find meaningful solutions for families with relatives suffering from acute mental health and substance abuse disorders. Perhaps the steepest hill to climb was tackling the changes that were necessary as well, the Mental Health Services Act. This year, we made a dramatic shift to focus the law on those struggling the most, to shift resources to housing and supportive services. This is the biggest effort in our lifetime to combat substance abuse and mental health as well. And this is a future that was advanced because of all of you. Proposition one, it's the future that you provided us. With the support of the California voters, we were able now to build over 11,000 new beds and housing units for those with the most challenging mental illness. And we're requiring counties and cities in the state to focus existing money on housing and treatment for the toughest cases. And critically, we're guaranteeing a portion of those homes will go to veterans living on the streets, many of them suffering from PTSD. All of this while never compromising on our nation-leading efforts to improve youth mental health with more school-based health professionals, new mobile apps, and platforms like Saluna to engage more kids earlier in prevention and screening. Think about a world in which we did nothing about this crisis, when we fell prey to the cynicism, negativity, and the rhetoric, and just rolled over and said it was simply unfixable. The same, by the way, is true of the red state approach to crime. They couldn't be more divorced from reality. Their entire crime agenda narrative is about diversion and distraction. They create fear and division. Meanwhile, people are gunned down at higher rates in Republican states than in Democratic states. Eight of the 10 most violent murder states in America are red states. Even cities like Jacksonville and in Memphis have significantly higher homicide rates than cities like San Francisco and Los Angeles. But that's not what you hear. Instead, you hear wall-to-wall right-wing media coverage about lawless blue cities and blue states. In fact, California's violent crime rate is about half of what it was in the 1990s, 1992, a lower homicide rate now than 29 other states, including Florida and Texas. And property crime, as an example, in San Francisco is down 32%. In Oakland, where the California Highway Patrol, in partnership with local law enforcement, we've seen a decline, a remarkable decline, 33% in crime. This is because in California, we take public safety seriously. We take it as a problem to solve, not just to flog on cable news. We didn't wake up to this yesterday. Beginning in 2019, we funded local police and prosecutors specifically to go after retail theft, not by defunding the police, but by recruiting, among other things, 1,000 CHP officers. But we're not satisfied until we get the job done. And to do that, I recognize we need to do more to clarify existing laws. And while it's true that California has some of the toughest felony theft thresholds in the nation, we need to do more to go after professional theft rings more forcefully. We look forward to advancing this package of reforms this year. Our work on public safety also means we protected victims of domestic violence with expanded restraining orders. We've cracked down on ghost guns. We've gone toe-to-toe with the gun lobby and ideological judges who advance their agenda. And we won't stop fighting because protecting Californians is our most important job. You know, 30 years ago, California's gun homicide rate was 50% above the national average. Now, today, it's 33% below the national average. That's because of our gun safety laws. And red states' refusal to follow California's lead has led to catastrophic impacts. Let's put it this way. If every state in America had California's gun death rate over the past decade, 140,000 Americans would be alive today. That's the cost of fealty to the ideological agenda by the National Rifle Association. 140,000 brothers and sisters and sons and daughters, mothers and fathers would be alive today. For lawmakers in red states, with respect, bravery sometimes just simply means ignoring the best interests of their constituents, I guess, in doing whatever the donors and the lobbyists tell them to do. That's not the approach we take in California. But we're facing unprecedented challenges. Not a single word from them about the Supreme Court's perversion of the Second Amendment that allows, for example, machine guns and weapons of war to proliferate on the streets of America. It's a sickness. Just a week ago, as a proof point, Republicans in the United States Senate refused to even outlaw bump stocks, the same so-called accessory that a gunman in Las Vegas used to kill 60 people, wound over 400, and dislodge over 1,000 rounds in just 11 minutes. That's why their states, with respect, are less safe. Catering to big business and the rich is also why red states tax their lowest earners far more than California does. Those red states punish you while you're struggling, but give you a free pass when you're wealthy. Here's the truth. Here's the truth Republicans will never tell you. California's not a high-tax state. Conservative states, this is a fact, conservative states tax their poorest residents, people struggling with two jobs, hospital bills, and childcare, at a higher rate than we tax our wealthiest residents. You pay a higher percentage of taxes if you're poor in Texas than you do if you're wealthy in California. It's about who you're fighting for. In California, you don't have to be profligate to be progressive. We understand how to balance budgets while protecting working families, children, and the most vulnerable in our state. Thanks to our partnership with Senator McGuire and Speaker Rivas, we just passed the first ever two-year balanced budget, a disciplined approach that keeps California on strong fiscal footing. And while the right wants to strip away protections for working families, we built this economy by valuing the dignity of work, cherishing family time, and honoring labor unions. You shouldn't have to be a CEO to live a decent life. And in California, you don't have to. The California spirit means working hard and being rewarded with a paycheck that meets your needs. All of our progress on higher wages and better benefits for working people is not just about the hourly pay. It's about building a future. It's about dignity. It's about respect, where everyone is included in our growth, and inclusion. We're a state that gives a damn, for example, about fast food workers, and proudly so, who are predominantly women, working 2.5 jobs to get by. And because of the leadership of the California legislature, these hard workers finally got a raise and job security that they deserve. And by the way, the companies themselves get a more stable workforce. California is the tentpole. We're the tentpole of the American economy. 16% of all of our nation's job creation last month came right here, came from the great state of California, because we value our workers and we value our workforce. But it doesn't end at a paycheck, because costs are still too high for too many people. Our most persistent challenge remains affordability. The issue that defines more issues in more ways and more days remains housing. An added stressor, of course, these days is not just the cost of housing, it's the cost and availability of housing insurance. And we're tackling that with more urgency now than ever, moving reforms and new laws quickly to stabilize our insurance market. But homeowner insurance is just one part, we know, of that larger affordability puzzle. For families, we're also doing a lot more. California policies are putting over $17,000 back into the pockets of families, offsetting the pressures of inflation, cost of groceries, childcare, and so many stresses that people are struggling through. We proudly offer a young child tax credit, an expanded earned income tax credit for working families, 5 days of paid sick leave, 8 weeks of family leave. We've created, with the legislature's support, over 120,000 new childcare slots. California has also taken action to protect the student's right to learn and a teacher's right to teach. In California, we don't just dream about a future where everyone has a chance to get ahead. We aren't passive bystanders. We're creating a new grade, a brand new grade, to give Californians an early start, pre-K for all, fully finishing the job by 2025. We're also building thousands of community schools with wraparound services for students and families. Students will be able to get free meals, behavioral health, family support, as well as high-dose tutoring. We're also finally fulfilling the vision of before and after school, as well as summer school for all, investing billions of dollars to make it universal. Around the state, we're deploying literacy coaches to thousands of schools. And next year, all kindergartners will begin routine screenings for reading difficulties, such as dyslexia, so we intervene as early as possible. These K-12 reforms are some of the most transformative reform policies in our state, and some of the most significant happening across the nation. We built a future where everyone can have access to community college for free. And we're ensuring more residents than ever can gain admissions to the University of California and the California state system. All this took commitment and lots of investment. But the payoff is big. Thousands of young Californians accessing the greatest public higher education system in America. Here's a simple question for Republicans. If California is such a failed state, why are four out of the seven most valuable companies in the world based here? Why does the Bay Area remain the top-ranked region in the world for venture capital? We've got more business startups in California than any other state in America and among the highest average wages than any state in America. We've added 63,000, talk about a wealth factory. We've added 63,000 new millionaires in California since 2019. And within the last few weeks, we learned yet again that California has retained its place as the fifth largest economy in the world. We've achieved record-breaking tourism, and our population is growing again. All of these facts fly in the face of the California haters who want to tear us down because they know our success is a spotlight, respectfully, on their own failures. California doesn't look away from its toughest problems. We embrace solutions that work and work for most people. Just look last week. We accomplished something that was seemingly impossible, reforming the Private Attorneys General Act, or PAGA. It's a complicated, thorny issue that for decades eluded compromise, bringing rational reforms and important labor protections at the same time, sensibly managing responsible concerns from small businesses. It's easier to address simple problems, but that's not the California way. I'll give you another example of California embracing big, complex issues without flinching. We're in the middle of the largest dam removal project in U.S. history, restoring some 400 miles of an historic river, and doing so, restoring a historic way of life that has sustained this state for thousands and thousands of years. We fast-tracked the construction of the first new large-scale above-ground water storage project sites in over half a century. And we're moving forward with the largest climate restoration project in the nation, the Delta Conveyance, protecting our water supplies while building resilience for the state's most important ecosystem. We know that protecting the environment improves our economy. Look no further for proof than California's economic dominance than the revolution that's happening right now with clean cars. California's home to 60 zero-emission vehicle headquartered companies, now one of our top exports. The global EV market simply would not exist but for California's clean air leadership. Our regulatory environment has been an accelerator for investment, creating certainty and unprecedented investment opportunities. We're creating jobs and whole new industries as we fight climate change. That's California innovation. That's California innovation in action. And we're moving forward in the face of oil-funded politicians all around us that are lying to us. They're trying to say that a clean economy somehow is a bad economy. But we're not asserting that. We're proving them wrong. We have six times more clean energy jobs than we do fossil fuel jobs. At the same time, we're holding big oil accountable. Accountable for their lies and accountable for their price gouging. We're suing them. We're suing them, yes, for defiling our planet, but also defending ourselves from their profit-driven greed, drilling their oil rigs next to houses and playgrounds and daycare centers. And we're operating the world's fifth largest economy on a carbon-free engine, 90 days since March alone, proving that clean future isn't only desirable, it's achievable. And even under these attacks, we're writing our own history as the epicenter of global innovation. Let me give you one more potent example. California is transforming an empty former mall in Los Angeles into a research and innovation hub in partnership with Google and UCLA. At the site, scientists, engineers, and researchers are helping solve some of the world's greatest challenges, from the frontiers of quantum computing to cutting-edge immunology research. We're also home to NVIDIA. Founded in Sunnyvale in 1993, it's now the world's most valuable company. As they grow, like so many companies like them, they're nurturing a startup ecosystem that will prove to be perhaps the most fertile in economic history. You know, it's no mistake that California is the epicenter of what is called the fourth industrial revolution, artificial intelligence. In fact, 35 of the world's 50 most exciting and largest market cap companies in AI are right here in California. Across the spectrum, California, it simply has no peers. Name an industry, and California dominates. Vast, productive farms and ranches that feed the world. In healthcare, in life science, in biotech, bioinnovation, in arts, in music, motion pictures, the best minds in the world, they call California home because they're liberated from the constraints of conformity and tradition. This is true freedom to invent and to make the world a better place. California has figured out a way to make it work time and time again, decade after decade. And in times like these, with deep divisions at home and around the rest of the world, I know it's easy to feel a little bit despair, but I'm hopeful. I'll give you another example of the remarkable people who live in this state. Thousands of Californians are now participating in community service programs that connect people through shared experiences. They work towards a common purpose. California has created a college core program that allows students to work up to 450 hours of community service and earn up to $10,000. At the same time, they're gaining valuable job experience. They also are gaining college credit, and perhaps most importantly, a sense of pride and purpose and meaning. And just over the last 5 years, we've also built more broadly our service corps into the largest volunteer organization in the country, larger now than the U.S. Peace Corps. 10,000 members strong with nearly 5 million hours of service. Every year, the people of California, well, they stun the world with something new that our detractors, they could never have dreamt of. The only surprise is they keep being surprised. In a state with a bigger balance sheet than many nations, it's easy to get lost often in facts and figures. It's easy to forget what our values truly represent, what they represent to the United States, for that matter, to the rest of the world. We're building a future where everyone feels protected, everyone feels connected and respected. We're building a state that transforms the world over and over and over again. We're a state that launched a farm worker revolution, a free speech revolution, a love revolution, a computing revolution, a biotech revolution, a climate revolution, and a quantum revolution. That's us. Weird, wild, free-spirited California, a place that can elect Ronald Reagan and Jerry Brown back to back, a place for Ayn Rand and Jane Fonda, for Metallica and Kendrick Lamar, a place that can invent the internet and the popsicle, blue jeans and Barbie. California is where the most creative people in the world want to be, whether they're born in Salinas, Tuscaloosa, or Bangalore. A place where a world-class education leads to a world-class job, where that world-class job leads to a brighter future, where standing out makes you outstanding. This is the future California is creating now. We're solving our most pressing problems with enthusiasm, resolve, and a California spirit that allows us to accomplish anything. Anyone who really knows California knows that the state of our state is strong and resilient, a beacon to the world. Thank you, California.